It's been called America's Dead Sea, Utah's Great Salt Lake. It's not entirely dead, but it is dying, erasing habitats, businesses, and memories, including mine. Utah's Great Salt Lake doesn't look so great these days. This place where tourists once bobbed up and down like corks in water far saltier than the ocean is now, quite literally, turning to dust.
It's just all so sad. Like, I just can't believe all this happened just since I was in high school.
This story hits pretty close to home. I grew up in Salt Lake City. We had a sailboat here. That's a shaggy-haired me hugging the mast. But today, this marina is lifeless. The only boats here now are sailing the blacktop of a nearby parking lot.
You'd go out the channel there, and as soon as you rounded the corner there, you just saw this huge expanse of water. I mean, to me, it was like the ocean.
But my ocean has shriveled. Once covering 2,300 square miles, today, Great Salt Lake is only a third that size.
Are you guys ready?
Yep.
Let's do it.
We took to the air to see for ourselves.
Normally, that would be full of water all the way up.
Andy Wallace was flying over these waters at about the same age I was sailing on them.
See that kind of island lens that's out
there?
That was completely underwater in the springs. That's emerged since then.
Have you noticed a difference year by year?
Oh, yeah.
The lake always had a cycle, depending on how much water was flowing into it. Some years it was low, and some years it was high. Like 1983, when floodwaters were diverted down city streets.
There are some people who say, oh, it's all going to change. Don't worry. We're going to go from dry to wet. This is just a big cycle.
Utah Senator and former GOP presidential candidate Mitt Romney believes this has gone far beyond the normal cycle.
Assuming that we're going to have a continuation of what we're seeing now, you've got to take action. What if action? And allowing the lake to dry up is not something we can allow.
Climate change and the West's historic mega drought certainly haven't done the lake any favors. But it's the diversion of water away from the lake that he says is less than divine.
The water in this area helped us bloom like a rose, as the scripture says. You know, we've got trees and beautiful lawns, but some of that's going to have to change.
Most of the lake's water is spoken for long before it gets there. And it's not just those green lawns for Utah's exploding population. 70% of the water goes to agriculture. And then there's the $1 billion-a-year mineral extraction industry. It uses the lake's water, too. Salt is obviously king here.
We produce about 1 million tons annually.
1 million tons?
Yeah.
But there's magnesium and lithium, too, says Joe Habesy, vice president of natural resources at Compass Minerals. If the lake dries up, he worries, so might thousands of local jobs.
When you appreciate the scope, the direct extraction, but then you have the indirect jobs, so vendors, contractors, trucking.
So just how bad is it, really? Well, a scientific report out just last month warns the lake is on track to disappear in the next 5 years, unless water use is cut by as much as 50% annually.
I don't know of any other environmental threat that's moving this quickly.
Bonnie Baxter is a Westminster College biochemist and one of the authors of that study.
Oh, you got the jackpot.
For 2 decades, she's been studying the lake's brine shrimp and brine flies. Not the most pleasant inhabitants, as I recall, but they were a nutritious food source for some 10 million migratory shorebirds. Those I remember fondly.
This year was pretty horrific. We didn't see a lot of flies, and the birds that eat the flies are really emaciated and struggling.
It sounds like you're talking about the whole ecosystem collapsing.
Exactly. When I'm out here, I have to walk away and cry often. I can't get through the day just thinking about the science. I have to take a moment.
It's emotional, to be sure. And that's not even the worst of it. A bigger problem is actually blowing in the wind. That's Kevin Perry, professor of atmospheric sciences at the University of Utah. He spent the last 15 years biking across the lake bed, trying to determine if the newly exposed soil poses any threat.
Every 500 meters, I would scoop up a soil sample.
And what he found was that it was laden with toxic heavy metals.
There were 9 elements that had concentrations out in the soil that are potentially alarming, but by far arsenic had the most widespread abundance.
Yep, he said arsenic. The same wind that used to blow sailboats around will also, he says, pick up that toxic dust and send it straight into the lungs of residents all along the Wasatch Front.
Trying to get a sense of how you quantify the danger. I mean, how big is the danger?
There are 2.5 million people that live within 50 miles of this lake. And all of those 2.5 million people are at risk from long-term exposure from the dust.
It's happened before, about 600 miles to the southwest at what used to be Owens Lake in California. Its inflows were diverted a century ago to provide water for the city of Los Angeles. But once its lake bottom was exposed, this area became the largest source of toxic dust in the nation.
How bad was it?
Really bad. It was 100 times or more over the federal air quality standard.
Philip Cadu is the pollution control officer here in the Great Basin, who oversees a massive operation to tamp down that dust using gravel, brush, and yes, more water.
How much does all that mitigation cost, though?
Today, $2.5 billion.
Just to basically fix the mistake?
To mitigate the mistake, yeah.
Wow.
I think the Owens Lake is a bellwether for the Great Salt Lake.
As hard as controlling the dust is here, consider this. Great Salt Lake is 12 times larger.
This would be exponentially more expensive, maybe not even possible.
Under the leadership of Brad Wilson, Republican Speaker of the Utah House, the state has passed a flood of water conservation measures. Utahns have responded by voluntarily saving about 9 billion gallons of water just last summer alone.
It's been almost unprecedented, really, on this issue, how everyone, regardless of political ideology or age or where they grew up, is aware of the lake and cares about it for various reasons.
President Biden just signed a bill co-sponsored by Senator Romney that allocates $25 million to monitor Great Salt Lake and others like it. But studying the problem and fixing it are two very different things.
My guess is the cost is going to be in the billions and billions of dollars. And how you fund that, that's another question.
Are you optimistic that we can fix it?
There's no question in my mind that we can fix it. The question is, will there be the public and political will to take the tough medicine? We're gonna have to take pretty aggressive action. If we don't, the consequence for all of us would be severe.
The last light to leave the Salt Lake Valley is from the sunsets that even now still reflect off the lake. It's been that way for thousands of years. I'd like to think, in geologic time anyway, Great Salt Lake is still too young to die. But I guess that's up to us.